We had three options laid out, two of which have virtually no role for the federal government in the housing finance system, the third of which preserves more. You know, we have at least one voice in the room suggesting that we really need to look at other options as well. So from a civil rights perspective, does it make sense for the federal government to completely pull out of the housing finance system, or what kind of a role do we need the government to play?
Well, it doesn't make sense for the federal government to pull out because, as Debbie was saying, in the last 30, 40, 50 years in the finance area of housing, and I've been doing this for 35 years, we've seen how Fannie and Freddie and their guarantees caused problems early on in the 60s, 70s, and then they changed some of their practices for the better in the 1980s. But throughout this whole time period, there's been an absence of the private market in underserved communities, as well as an absence for families with low and moderate incomes. And just to be clear, the Federal Fair Housing Act covers race, color, national origin, religion, sex, families with kids, and people with disabilities. So from a fair housing perspective, government involvement in the housing finance system is absolutely essential. If we're going to have mortgage credit that is actually delivered in a fair and equitable manner and builds our communities rather than destroys our communities and helps now, at this point, rebuild the wealth that's been stripped from our communities. In the absence of federal incentives or interventions, the mainstream housing finance system will likely leave entire communities and geographies just as it did up until the CRA was passed and then enforcement by many of us to make sure that they were taking deposits from communities and putting loans back into those communities. But that didn't happen nationwide. When Congress passed the Federal Fair Housing Act in 1968, it certainly understood that racial and ethnic segregation and discrimination were tearing our nation apart. Before the bill was passed, President Lyndon Johnson pulled together the Kerner Commission, and many of you are way too young to know about the Kerner Commission report, which came out in 1968, right after the law was passed, talking about two Americas, a black and white America, and they were separate and unequal. And while we've made great progress since 1968, we still suffer from some of the fundamental issues that were raised in the Kerner Commission report. Discrimination in the housing market by real estate individuals, by loan originators, by appraisers, by homeowners insurance companies, by the secondary market. Those things have improved dramatically, because back then, Dr. King, right before his assassination, was in Chicago, and he sent out 100 African Americans and 100 white people to real estate offices in Metro Chicago. Every single African American was told there were no homes to be shown to them in white neighborhoods. So we've come a long, long way. But you know, if we've got to go this far, I think we're only here, and we have a long ways to continue. You know, if you're African American, Latino, Asian American, or immigrants, you were probably likely and living in segregated communities, you got subprime loans. And we know from all the studies that high-income African Americans and Latinos and Asian Americans were more likely to be steered into these subprime products. So when you look at the history, current and past history of discrimination and lending, we can't allow the private market to have sole responsibility for making sure credit is available in the housing sector for people. It just isn't going to work. The secondary market and the private market allowed and encouraged and fostered the abuses that we saw with the subprime market. They did that in many different ways. One, in the secondary market, was offering premiums to banks and mortgage companies to pull in the arms and the exploding arms and the exotic products. but I don't want to take a lot of time because everybody has something to say. So let me just wrap up by saying that government support for the market is a must, and it must come with certain obligations. Under the Fair Housing Act, there's a section that says that you must affirmatively further fair housing. And you heard the Secretary talk about affirmatively furthering fair housing. But what I think a lot of people don't know is it's written into the law, and it's written into the Housing and Community Development Act of 1974. And all federal dollars, DOD money, Department of Education, all federal dollars are supposed to be used in a way that affirmatively furthers fair housing. And that means not only reducing and eliminating housing discrimination, it means affirmatively promoting residential integration. And after 35 years, I can tell you, I don't see the private industry doing that. I don't see the banks doing those two things. I see fair housing offices within the lenders, and I'm pleased to see that. I see CRA officers in the lenders, and I'm pleased to see that. But if we look back what's happened over the last 9 years, not just 3 or 4 years, starting with the predatory loans in the black community where they perfected their way to rip people off till they were able to spread it into the middle class white communities, we cannot rely on the private sector to do the right thing.
Thank you, Shanna. So Hilary, Shanna's talking about, you know, the two Americas that we've seen in the past, separate and unequal. Does that apply to the credit market? Do we have two credit markets?
Absolutely. As a matter of fact, as we looked at what occurred over the last few years, we recognized a couple things happening. Some of it goes back to the old school things that Shanna was talking about, the redlining, the targeting of racial and ethnic minorities, the more vulnerable in our society, for loan products they could not sustain. So we start seeing this, even those that had the credit ratings, those that had the income and other things that are taken into consideration for prime loans, were still steered into subprime packages. So indeed, we found African Americans and Latinos and other people of color, again, steered into that secondary level. Higher origination fees, higher interest rates, more challenging and problematic oversight that clearly led to many of the problems we had and gave those predatory lenders the opportunity to really hone in on our communities and exploit our communities the way that they did. So indeed, that has been the problem. So if you look at the front end, we do need the federal government actively involved in the process of making sure we leverage against those private industries to make sure that the arguments they make about the risk factors that are involved are protected through guarantees by the federal government giving broader opportunities. The back end is we still need the federal government involved in the oversight, the regulatory oversight and enforcement of those policies in place. We would argue that most of the policies that prevent the kind of downturn, the kind of problems and discrimination, the exploitation that happened in the racial and ethnic minority communities, we had safeguards in place, but we didn't have the vigorous enforcement of those safeguards. And as such, we were really taken advantage of. So certainly the federal government has a key role to play, but it has to step up to the plate and do it. I was very excited about some of the things Secretary Donovan said. Limited options, but options nonetheless. And our hope is that we can add a few more options to this plate as we move ahead and talk about this issue.
So Hilary, you're talking about the kind of loan products that were out there.
Absolutely.
But when you listen to the popular debate, kind of the popular narrative about the crisis that we've been going through, often what you hear is, you know, these were homeowners who overreached, or, you know, people who really shouldn't be homeowners, they couldn't afford the houses that they bought, and it was really the borrower's problem. So Marc, can you just comment on, have we overdone home ownership in this country? Do we need to be scaling back?
No. The narrative that we hear all too often is what I call the weapon of mass deception, which is a campaign to suggest that the reason for the mortgage meltdown was the Community Reinvestment Act, lending to people of color, lending to unworthy borrowers. That's a narrative that has taken hold in too many places where too many intelligent and influential people should know better. And I don't set aside the fact that there are people who made bad bets, bad decisions, who maybe should not have become homeowners, but let's forcibly push back against the narrative with what are the facts. The second thing is, just Shanna mentioned, and I want to add to this, we need to take ourselves back to the homeownership America before the federal government forcibly intervened. Let me tell you about that America. That was an America where the way you bought a house is with cash. That's an America where maybe you could get 50% financed and you put 50% down. That's the homeownership America of 1920, 1930, 1940, and to some extent into the early 50s. It was also an America where slums and unhealthy living conditions were the rule in many urban communities, when non-working plumbing facilities, where heat wasn't there. That was the rule. We need to take ourselves back so that this discussion that is being played out is not being played out in only an esoteric and intellectual level. Housing is a basic human need. It's a basic necessity. There was a generation that utilized the post-depression and World War II time period to build the American middle class. It was a combination of civil rights, it was government intervention, it was a wide range of things, because the opportunity to build the economy of the 50s and 60s and the 70s was a challenge that a generation took up. I'm concerned that somehow the reaction to this crisis is retrenchment. The turning back of the clock to an America that somehow some people are nostalgic about, but was not a very, very, very equitable place, or a place where there was great and broad-based quality of life. So our role, our job, our responsibility is to ask the tough, hard, penetrating, and precise questions, to subject these proposals to hard questions. What real impact will it have on affordable housing? What impact will it have on the availability of the emerging communities of color to join the ownership class, to become homeowners in 21st century America? What will it do to create a competitive mortgage market and not an oligopolistic mortgage market in 21st century America? We have to ask those important questions.